Here in America, people buy 3 billion of these every year. Not double A's, but batteries in general. And without some kind of battery to keep your phones ringing, your laptops searching, your flashlights ready, your cars starting, what would you do? We're totally dependent on battery technology, and even though it's changed drastically in just the past few decades, the basic idea goes back thousands of years. So, how did we get here, and where does battery power go from here? In the simplest terms, a battery is a device that stores potential chemical energy and converts it into electricity through reactions known as oxidation-reduction reactions. Any battery is basically an electrochemical cell, and in order for it to work, it has to have three things. A positive electrode, or cathode, that wants more electrons, a negative electrode, or anode, that gives up electrons, and an electrolyte that allows ions to move back and forth between the first two, thereby creating a flow of electricity. You probably heard from us or someone else how to make a battery out of a lemon, where you can see these principles at work. Just take some copper wire, which acts as the cathode, a zinc-coated nail for the anode, and a lemon, which provides the electrolyte medium that connects the two. The difference in electronegativity between the anode and the cathode causes the reactions that produce a small charge of electricity. It took a while for humans to get wise to the idea that these stored electrical charges could be useful. In the late 1930s, German archaeologist Wilhelm Koenig was poking around in Baghdad when he dug up an unusual artifact that made the world rethink the origin of batteries. It was a 13-centimeter clay jar that held an iron rod encased in a copper cylinder and contained traces of an acidic liquid, probably wine or vinegar. It was a really, really, really old battery, like 2,000 years old. This blew some minds, and the artifact remains kind of an oddity. Experts debate what these batteries might have been useful for, but some believe they were tools in electroplating, the process of using electricity to apply a thin layer of gold or other metal onto a different metal to make jewelry and other ornaments. Scientists have actually replicated these battery jars and found that they can produce 1 to 2 volts of electricity. For sure, batteries have improved a lot since then, but the basic concept has essentially remained the same as those Baghdad jars. Italian physicist Count Alessandro Volta was long credited with creating the very first modernish battery back in the late 1700s. He stacked layers of brine-soaked paper between silver and zinc plates to form what became known as a voltaic pile that emitted a steady current of electricity. Today, we measure electromotive force in volts, in Volta's honor. But while everybody agreed that this pile was pretty sweet, it did have some major drawbacks, like how the salt water quickly corroded the metal plates. It wasn't until around 1836 that English chemist John Daniel made some major improvements. He invented the Daniel cell by placing a copper plate at the bottom of a glass jar half full with copper sulfate solution, then topped it off with a zinc plate suspended in a zinc sulfate solution. The copper and zinc work on the same principles as that lemon battery we talked about, but in Daniel's cell, because the copper solution is denser, it kept the bottom of the jar while the zinc solution remained floating at the top, thus creating the first positive on the copper end and negative on the zinc end terminals of a battery. As long as the Daniel cell remained still, like motionless, it worked like a charm, powering things like doorbells and telephones for years. It took another several decades for new improvements to pop up. In the mid-1860s, Frenchman Georges Leclanchet developed a contained carbon zinc wet cell. It was smaller, more rugged, longer lasting than the Daniel cell, though it still worked by immersing its electrodes in an acidic solution, in this case, ammonium chloride. Later improvements used a barely moist paste of ammonium chloride as the electrolyte instead of a liquid, which meant that the battery could be jostled around without spilling all over the place. This was the dry cell battery concept, which we still see today in alkaline zinc carbon and mercury batteries. By the end of the 19th century, the National Carbon Company began selling the first commercial batteries in the US. That company eventually morphed into EverReady, which then became Energizer, which this guy here. And while today's batteries come in a wide range of shapes and sizes and materials, they all function basically the same way. Whether they're made of alkaline, zinc, lead acid, or lithium, the electrochemical reaction and all three key components of anode, cathode, and electrolyte all remain. Today, the biggest difference in battery types is between primary, or disposable, and secondary, or rechargeable batteries. Disposable batteries are one-shot wonders. They produce electricity so long as the anode's chemicals keep releasing electrons, and the cathode keeps accepting those electrons through the electrolyte. But once the chemical reactants are drained, the reactions stop and the battery dies, and the lights go out. These include your everyday alkaline batteries, which use an aqueous alkaline for the electrolyte. They typically connect a zinc anode to a cathode made of manganese dioxide. Rechargeable batteries, like nickel-cadmium or the lithium-ion ones tucked into your laptop, operate a lot more like two-way streets. They lose all their chemical juice while producing electricity, but they can be recharged when plugged into an electrical source because the particular chemical reactions they use can be reversed. Lithium is a super, super reactive element, and its ions can be used to store a ton of energy. Lithium lithium-ion batteries use lithium cobalt oxide as the positive electrode, carbon as the negative, and an organic solvent, often ether, for the electrolyte. These batteries are generally far lighter than other types of similarly sized rechargeable batteries, which makes them particularly good for use in mobile devices. They also use oxidation reduction reactions, of course, but because of the particular materials they use, their chemical reactions can be reversed with the input of energy, and subsequently charged back up. So when your laptop's on battery mode, discharging its juice, those lithium ions are moving from the negative carbon electrode over to the positive lithium cobalt oxide electrode. But when the battery gets plugged into the wall, it recharges itself when those ions move back from the positive electrode to the negative side. It's like if you could put the electrons back into the zinc-covered nail in your lemon battery and take them out of the copper wire over and over again. Thanks to lithium, you can. The fact that you find rechargeable batteries all over the place now, but you didn't like 20 or 30 years ago, might make you think that they're a fairly new invention. But they've actually been around for over 150 years. Or at least one of them has. In 1859, Gaston Planté invented the lead-acid battery, the very first ever rechargeable battery. This heavy but effective wet cell combined a lead anode and a lead dioxide cathode bathed in a tub of sulfuric acid, and it worked so well that it is still starting cars today! Lead-acid batteries do a great job of delivering a big burst of energy to start your car's engine, and then ration out extra energy for running your radio and lights and AC and iPod while the gas-powered engine takes over the work of moving the car. But electric and hybrid cars ask a whole lot more of their batteries, and old-school lead-acid rechargeables just aren't enough to push around a Chevy Volt. So while an electric car might get an average of 130 kilometers off the juice of a lead-acid battery, a battery that uses your old friend lithium gets closer to 350 kilometers off a single charge. Not only that, but lead-acid batteries can only be recharged so many times before they die for good, which you probably already know if you've had to jumpstart your rig multiple times. But lithium-ion batteries recharge nearly perfectly and can be drained and juiced back up hundreds of times without losing efficiency. Many believe the future of electric cars depends on building better and more efficient and more affordable lithium-ion batteries. Still, electric car technology has a ways to go. As it stands, not everyone has the time or patience to return home and recharge a 450 kilogram, yes, they are that heavy, battery for 8 hours a day. And the compounds that they run on do eventually get depleted, after about 5 years or 160,000 kilometers, at which point you gotta shell out 10,000 bucks for a new one, or just get a new car. So yeah, some kinks to work out. But hey, we're getting there. The chemistry of batteries makes possible all of the electronic wizardry around you, and it's pretty darn cool to consider the basic function of those 2,000-year-old Baghdad jars hasn't changed that much, from electroplating ancient jewelry, to you watching me right now, to the future of electric vehicles. Thank you for watching this SciShow Infusion, and thanks especially to our subbable subscribers, without whom we could not make the show. How would you like your own personal message down there in the doobly-doo, or what about a picture tweeted from our studio to you? To find out about these and other awesome perks, go to subbable.com, or find us on Facebook and Twitter, and don't forget to go to youtube.com/SciShow and subscribe.